The wild creatures of South Georgia are noisy.
They sound like kazoos.
And playful.
Look at these young fur seals in this shipwreck.
But the landscape and the explorers who first came here have their own stories to tell. I'm Alizé Carrère, an environmental anthropologist and National Geographic explorer. This is my friend Tom Ritchie, a naturalist who spent decades in the field. Together, we'll discover what it means to be a modern explorer. Today, we're going on an expedition to South Georgia, an island within the Antarctic climate. It's an island covered with rugged peaks, capped with snow year-round. But there's still plenty of exposed rock this summer.
Well, that water would probably be so good to drink.
So you really think I can drink this water?
Oh, I'm sure that is as pure a water as you could find anywhere on Earth.
Let's try it. Pretty good.
Yeah.
This is pristine glacier water. Over 100 glaciers have been mapped on South Georgia.
I can't get over how thin these glaciers look.
Yeah, they're all in big retreat.
Most are now in retreat, meaning they don't extend as far as they used to. My research, the kind of exploring I do when I'm not here, focuses on how the environment is changing and what we'll do to adapt.
It's also kind of shocking to look at the glaciers.
Oh my gosh.
Everywhere we can see, there are glaciers in retreat.
So this one would have gone out to sea right there.
It went right down to there.
Imagine what the explorers of the past might have seen in these mountains. One such explorer was Ernest Shackleton. He completed the first documented crossing of South Georgia in 1916, while on a mission to rescue stranded members of his ill-fated trans-Antarctic expedition aboard the Endurance. When they set off from South Georgia in 1914, the Endurance crew was taking a huge risk, one unimaginable today.
They had no long-range weather forecasts to guide them, and they couldn't have known they were sailing toward disaster.
The thick pack ice trapped and then slowly crushed the Endurance, leaving the men stranded with no choice but to survive on the ice. They eventually found refuge on a tiny island off the tip of the Antarctic Peninsula. They were finally on dry ground. Today, we might use modern tech to call for help, but Shackleton didn't have that option. So he packed a few of his men in a lifeboat to look for rescue. After an 800-mile journey, Shackleton returned to South Georgia. It had been 17 months since the Endurance first set sail. But the ordeal wasn't over yet. To call for help, they'd need to reach a whaling station on the other side of the island. That's what pushed Shackleton to make the first crossing of South Georgia.
They came down into that valley.
To where? Oh, right here?
Right there, and then realized this was the wrong bay. And then walked down here and then did what we're doing right now.
So that would have been, what, in the middle of winter?
Yeah.
So this would have all been covered with snow.
Right.
Do you know how many days it took them?
To cross?
To do this South Georgia crossing.
About 36 hours. He tells the story of letting the two guys with him, Frank Worsley and Tom Crean, go to sleep. And he knew that it was very dangerous to go to sleep in conditions like this. And so he just waited until he saw that both of them were in deep sleep and then woke them up and got them moving again.
Gosh, the leadership that you have to have for that type of a journey, that's almost like a playing on your psychology, you know?
Yes.
Like, yes, you're so rested.
I wonder if Shackleton and his guys admired the beauty of the places they were struggling through here.
Well, based on what we know about him, I have pretty good faith that he had some of that perspective.
Yeah.
We're coming up on the whaling station that would mean rescue for Shackleton, if only he could get there.
Look at that.
Wow.
And they left South Georgia on December 5th,
1914, and they got back here on May 20th, 1916. After that incredible sojourn, the 16 days crossing the roughest waters in the world in a little boat, and then having to trek all the way across this unknown mountainous island, this is where they reached on that early morning.
Right where we are.
Right where we are. And they listened and they heard the 7 o'clock whistle blow telling the men to turn out.
Shackleton was able to alert the station and send rescue for his remaining crew. They kept lookout every day, but spirits were low. It had been 4 months since their captain left them for help. But on August 30th, 1916, Shackleton returned in a tugboat to rescue his crew.
We made many interesting geological and scientific discoveries and had many narrow escapes throughout the whole time without the loss of a single human life.
Their expedition was a failure, but because of Shackleton's leadership, every man survived.
So this kind of is the end point in our track of Shackleton saga.
Where's the boss?
He's right up here, head of the cemetery.
Shackleton died of a heart attack in 1922, here on South Georgia.
Ernest Henry Shackleton, explorer. Wow. The title explorer in his context has so much meaning. And nowadays, what is it to be an explorer?
Yeah,
that definition's changing.
It is. It is changing, yes.
Our tools are different. Our technology is different. And the landscape is changing. Exploring means something very different from the past. But there will always be room to observe and protect the wonder of our world. And that's what makes a modern explorer.